In last week's video, we talked about three ways to help kids who are struggling with subtraction facts. One of the ways was to help them build the connection between addition and subtraction. But that is easier said than done. I'm Christina Tondevold, the Recovering Traditionalist, and today we're going to take a look at building the connection between addition and subtraction, and also multiplication and division in our quest to build our math minds so we can build the math minds of our students. Now, building that connections between the operations is often referred to inverse operations. The inverse of addition is subtraction. The inverse of subtraction is addition. And the same goes for multiplication and division. One of those big aha moments mathematically in my own history was the moment that I realized I never have to subtract again. I can use addition to solve any subtraction problem. Now, sometimes it may be easier to just subtract, but the understanding that I can use addition to help me subtract was a huge game changer for me. I know that seems like a big overstatement, but it really wasn't. It really did change the way that I thought about mathematics and about the operations. Unfortunately, that moment didn't come until I was an adult, but it really did help me to be able to do math mentally. I always struggled when I needed to do subtraction or division mentally. I needed paper and pencil to write it down and really go through the steps and algorithms that I had been taught to be able to figure out the answers. But once I learned that I could use my understanding of addition to solve subtraction, or my understanding of multiplication to help me solve division, I was finally able to do those operations mentally. Now, I do multi-digit subtraction and division using those inverse operations, but it all really starts when kids are young and we're helping them see those connections between the operations using just small numbers. But no matter what grade level you teach, if your kiddos have not built this understanding of inverse operations, we really do need to do that for them. And there's three things that I feel like you can do to help them build that. So let's get into it. Number one is to help kids understand key concepts, not keywords. I know I was that teacher. I had the keywords poster up there. I taught my kids to use keywords to help them solve and story problems, but really, it's not about keywords. It's about helping kids develop key concepts. This image right here is from Sue O'Connell's work from the book Introduction to Problem Solving. And that was a big part of what helped me better understand these inverse operations, was when I really understood the key concepts, which is, what does it mean to add? Adding is when we put things together. Subtraction is when we take things apart. We take away a certain amount. It also is when we're comparing two amounts and we're looking at the difference between the two amounts. And then multiplication is when we're putting things together again, but it's when we're putting things together that are the same sized sets. And then division is when we're separating that amount into certain groups. We're either trying to separate into a certain number of groups, or we're trying to separate knowing how many are in each group, or we're trying to find one of those things. So once I understood these key concepts, it really did better help me understand how subtraction is related to addition, how division is related to multiplication, and even how addition is related to multiplication and subtraction is related to division. It really does help me see how all four of them are connected, but in particular, in this video, we're talking about how addition is related to subtraction and multiplication is related to division. And to help kids see those connections, it comes from our second recommendation here, which is using lots of math story problems. When you put math in a contextual situation for kids, it really does help them better understand these key concepts. If you're looking for a way to help kids understand those, put the mathematics in context. If I just have 3 plus 4, it doesn't really tell me anything about 3 plus 4. That's why we need those key words. But if we put it into a contextual situation, otherwise known as story problems, then kids actually have a context wrapped around those problems. So kids can solve problems when they're in a context that they can't do when it's just numbers on a piece of paper, because they can actually imagine the situation and they can act it out oftentimes. So put the mathematics into story problems and then have the kids really delve into those key concepts, have them compare and contrast different types of situations. That's what really helps them focus in on key concepts and see the connection between the key concept of multiplication and the key concept of division. So here's an example here. Let's start with a multiplication problem where Christina has 5 boxes of cupcakes. Each box has 4 cupcakes. How many cupcakes does Christina have? Right? That is a multiplication problem. If you're just pulling the numbers out and multiplying, it's a contextual situation that involves multiplication. But this next problem, if you do them together, you do this multiplication problem, and then you also do this next problem that is technically division, it helps kids see the connection between. So our second problem is Christina has 20 cupcakes. The boxes she has for them will only hold 4 cupcakes in each box. How many boxes will Christina need for her cupcakes? And it's not about just having kids solve it. That's what I want you to take away from this one. Yes, we want kids to be able to solve story problems, but when we're showing these two together, it's more about doing a same but different type task with them, where we're showing these problems and we're asking, what's the same? What's different? What does that mean? What's the key concept we're doing in each? And then you can even model them alongside with it. So here's a model showing this first one where we've got the 5 boxes, 4 cupcakes in each box, and then we're trying to figure out how many it is. Well, then how would we model the second one? How do we show that Christina has 20 cupcakes and she can put 4 in each box? It starts out like this, but then how do we build it from there? Where do we go? How is that similar to how we modeled the first problem, right? All of these things. It isn't just about having kids solve problems in a context. It's about spending the time talking about the connections that can be made. And here I'm showing an example with multiplication and division, but the same thing holds true for addition and subtraction. Show a problem that is addition, and then use the exact same context, exact same numbers, but turn it into a subtraction-based problem. And then talk about how the modeling of each is similar but different, how the actual problem is similar but different, and help kids build the connections between those. Okay, so our third one that we're going to take a look at is kids do need practice. They need practice with seeing the connections between these inverse operations. But it's not just fact family practice. I have seen so many lessons and textbooks and worksheets that are out there on the internet about just worksheets of fact families. It isn't enough about having kids see that 4 plus 3 is similar to 7 minus 3. We want them to talk about, again, what's the same, what's different, what connections can we build here? So doing a number string is really, really powerful to do this. It's very like having a worksheet, but it's doing purposeful practice. I am picking these problems on purpose so that we can have a discussion about it. It's not just having them solve to find all the answers. The power comes when we have the discussion about how these are the same and how they are different. So if I start out with 4 plus 3 and the kids, we talk about that it's 7. The next problem is 7 minus 3. I don't want them to just give me the answer. I want to have discussion about how is this the same as that last problem we just did? How is it different? How does 4 plus 3 help you know what 7 minus 3 is? And then I can move into 7 minus 4. And you might even put 3 plus 4. And you can talk about commutative property here. You can create these number strings in whatever fashion you want. But the idea behind the creation of this number string is, yes, we are doing fact families. It's purposeful practice. But the point of it is not just the practice. It's the discussion and the connections we're helping kids build as they do it. And it doesn't have to be just the abstract version I have here. I made some images using the website brainingcamp.com. I love them for their virtual manipulatives. You could do it on any virtual manipulative site, but these ones were made on Braining Camp, so I want to give them credit. That's where these images came from. I did do some doctoring on some of these. So in the first one, this is exactly what it looks like on Braining Camp. But for the next one, I decided, what would it look like if I'm showing that connection between subtraction, so we're going down, but I didn't want to have the tick marks in there. So I just did a full arrow, which you can do in Braining Camp, but then I did some editing magic and deleted the boxes underneath. I didn't want those there because I was afraid kids would just see three boxes and try to say three. So I really wanted their own thinking to come out. So I got rid of the boxes there to be able to show that a little bit better. But the idea is I'm showing the addition version here. 3 plus 4 gives me something, but then I'm showing a subtraction version right after it. 7 minus something gives me 3. And then the next one I did was 4 plus, and you can see the 3 gives me what? And then on the next one, I'm showing 7, and then I'm taking away the 3, and what am I going to end at? And again, you could modify these. You could change it up. Maybe you don't want them side by side. Maybe you want them to disappear and then reappear. You could do all kinds of things to be able to animate these visuals. But the point is that it doesn't have to be just the abstract version of the fact families. It can also be showing the connection between addition and subtraction or multiplication and division using the models that kids are being exposed to. Okay? We want them to be able to have that purposeful conversation about the connections between these operations, and that can come by doing the problems, but it can also come by the visuals that we help kids see. So when we are helping kids understand the key concepts, we're helping them see connections between those contextual story problems between the operations, and we give them purposeful practice that builds the relationships and connections, we are helping them build an understanding of the inverse operations that is going to progress and develop into them actually understanding algebra. How many of us really understood algebra? The cool part about algebra is it's a lot of just understanding inverse operations. And if we can start that at a very early age to help our kids understand and become fluent with the operations, and the byproduct is that they're going to understand algebra even better, to me, that's a win-win, right? But reminder, it isn't just about having kids work on their fact families. It really is about building that understanding of the operations and the connections between the operations and putting those types of experiences into place in your classroom that help the kiddos do that. So I hope that this video has helped you build your math mind so you can go build the math minds of your students. Have a great day.